I'll give you tissues, Karen.
It's okay.
I'll bring the tissues here.
Thanks.
Okay, you got it. What are you going to do with it?
I don't know. What are we going to do with it, Paris?
Well, we're going to try and use it.
And my grandchildren know that they went to see the film. My son went to
Schindler's List.
Schindler's List.
Yeah. So why don't you tell me about where you were born and, you know, tell me about when you were a little girl. Where were you born?
I was born in Czechoslovakia.
Uh-huh.
And before I was born, my father was in the World War I 4 years.
Yeah.
Can I hear it too? After that?
Yeah. Okay, so you were born.
No, you can take the floor. You can move and can bring the chair here. I gotta find a place for the floor.
So, okay, so you were born in Czechoslovakia, yeah? When were you born?
What?
When were you born?
Yeah, I forget today.
How old are you?
60.
Wow.
I'm not looking for 60.
No.
I'm not really exactly. My husband is I'm younger from him.
Mm-hmm. Where were you born?
Czechoslovakia.
What city?
Baku. A little small place.
Is it near Prague?
Near Munkac.
Ah, so where?
My husband is from Munkac.
And what about your parents and your grandparents? Where were they from?
I don't know where my grandparents were born, but not even my father was born in the same place. My mother was born in Slovakia, in Slovakia.
Can you tell me about what it was like growing up there, and how old were you when the war broke out?
Well, when I broke out, I only was 16 years old. I was in school, still in school.
Do you remember the day that you learned that the war broke out?
Yeah. Shabbos, they took us away Friday. No, but when they took us in the concentration camp. Wait a minute, I didn't tell you about my home.
Right, tell us about
your first, when my father came home from the war, and, well, I just was born after far away when my father was home already. I had sisters and brothers. I had three brothers and two sisters before I was born. And when my father came home, my mother, under the war, she was very poor, but when my father came home and they worked, my mother was a big businesswoman. And they had a little store, but got bigger and bigger, and you can listen to that. And he wanted to buy, was a big lot from them Christian men, and he said, I'm not going to sell it, to you. And my father went over to a rabbi, and he said, and the guy will minister Kaip. You understand what I said? Jewish? No. Nobody knows. The Christian don't want to sell me this place. You know, that time the rabbi is such a power. And he said, go home. He's going to give it to you. And when he came home, he came to my father and said, I'm selling it for you. Because because of the rabbi. It's such a power.
What rabbi was it?
There was Paul, and that was not too far from us in a city. He used to come to us to the house too. He wasn't real. He had that, you know, how to say it, the shaky crank out in me two rabbis. My father gave up the whole house. My father built a big store in the, you know what he built? You know what a Knossos Archam is? He built a Knossos Archam, and my mother cooked and baked, and he was in the business. And suddenly, we don't know how, we got rich. Bona Shalom paid us back. And in my time, my father had a lot of money, a lot. gave, you know, they diary, they gave 40,000 checks. Coroner was more than $40,000, much more. And I have a very nice, I grew up, it was very nice when in my time. I had the most expensive clothes, fur coat, because my father had a lot of money. And everything, beautiful home and everything. And then the tourists came.
What kind of business did he do, your father?
We had everything, how to say it, general. You name it, shoes, women's lingerie, in grocery, you name it, whatever is everything.
You mean a general store?
General store. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And your mother helped him in the business?
Well, she was the big one. She the one who did it. Mm-hmm. My mother cooked for the poor people, five, six, wherever.
Where was the Haknas HaSorchim?
We did it. It was ours.
In your house?
Not in our house. It was a big lot. There was another building we built, separate.
Oh, nearby where you lived?
Yeah, at the same place, just a few yards away.
Uh-huh. And that's what the Christians sold you the lot?
Yeah. Uh-huh. And then we had a big garden and all kind of stuff. He sold it us. Uh-huh. The Rebbe told him to go home and you're going to give it to him. He did.
Mm-hmm. So what kind of people came to the Haknas HaSorchim?
Poor people. Poor. We gave them food and money and then material. Suddenly we had a big store. My father had even, you know, how to say it. I know Hungarian better. I know English too. And I know Czech language too. The American don't know German. I don't know how to say it, but like, corn and wheat and big and sold it, you have everything.
Mm-hmm. And how long did the people stay in the Haknas HaSorchim?
No, they passed by. They didn't stay. They slept over and then they went away.
Mm-hmm. And Shabbos,
the morning.
Shabbos, you would give them.
Also? We had Shabbos. Always we have Shabbos one person in our table, Shabbos.
Tell me about your Shabbos table in those early days.
It was very nice. Well, once we got scared, one of them was there, my brother, and he fainted. My mother was a scary one, was scared, and they found out he had that, you know how they call that sickness, where you fall down in...
Epilepsy?
Yeah. Good thing my brother was home, and he put a pail of water on him, and then he waked up.
So how many children were you all together?
We were seven. Four girls and three brothers.
And you were the youngest?
I have a sister in Cleveland.
You were the youngest or?
And I was second youngest. Uh-huh. The other one was all older. They was born before the war. I was born when my father came home, far away.
Came home from where?
From the war. He was 4 years in the World War One.
Uh-huh. Where did he go to
war? Weisshanton, tall man.
Where did he go to World War One? Where was he stationed?
He stationed in Hungary, uh-huh. All over.
Uh-huh. And what did he do? He fought?
What?
What did he do in the war?
What is people doing in the war? They send them here and there. They're killing people there. He came home, not even touched on the bomb, even a finger. His, you know what his overseas? His overseas, my parents, did so many good things, and that goes of their children, they go to Teresa, they go of seven generations, what they did. Sometimes I see my mother in my dream,
really?
And my father.
What do you see?
Wait a minute. Yeah, when they came home, when we went to the concentration camp, my mother had a lot of jewelry. It was a Jewish doctor, and we gave it to her. And then they left her because they sent away everybody. Then after that, they took her and she gave the jewelry to her. They left a couple. She was half Jewish and he was Jewish. They was very rich, and they left them. And she gave the jewelry to them. And as soon as we came home, I didn't came home. I was married first. Then I came to see my home, and she gave back. She found out somebody's alive. She gave back all the jewelry to my brothers and sisters. Well, I wasn't there because I came home. I went to Budapest after the war. Yeah? Met my husband in 1945. I was married in 1945.
How old were you?
You know, we're getting the 50th wedding anniversary that summer. Mm.
So how old were you when you got married?
16.
Well, you said the war started when you were 16.
That's what, no, I wasn't in life and mother. The war started in 14. 1914, and ended in, I was born, 1908, my husband, my father was in war, in the war.
No, I'm saying World War II.
No, the World War II.
How old were you?
When the start, no, that was, the Hungarian came in already. We had such a nice life in Czechoslovakia.
What was Jewish life like in Czechoslovakia, do you remember it? You remember what Yontif was like in Czechoslovakia?
The life?
Right. Yontif. What was Yontif, Shabbos, what was it?
Shabbos like? Was Shabbos, Yontif was Yontif. The Czechs said that the president, he likes the Jewish nations. He went even to Minka Cherevi for a brocha. That's how it was. The Jews was Ivan, that's never going to happen. You know, I went away to Czech school. Well, I wanted to speak Czech language. So two girls told me, in Czech language, as I'm a Jew. You know what I did? I went away to the principal and I told them. They took the two girls and they locked them up till dark because they told me this. We was up. And then the Jews, all the factories and big business was in Jewish hands. Everything. Yeah, it's never going to happen anymore. So, I went every day with the train, with my sister, every day for a season, then I learned, and I speak the language, Czech language.
When did you go to the camps? What happened? Do you remember?
Concentration camp.
Do you remember the day that it happened? Remember the day?
Yeah. I lived in Connecticut, and a journalist was next door and came to me to tell all about it, and I don't want to tell. I want to write in the newspapers. I just don't want to talk about it.
Must be hard to talk about. It's hard to talk about.
Yeah. What did you ask me?
Do you remember the day that you went?
Yeah, they took us first. Everything happened, troubles. They took us for in a ghetto.
Which ghetto?
We was there, it's called Barracks House, like Munkat Barracks House, a city. And we was there about 4 weeks, and then everything happened Shabbos. I came in Shabbos of Auschwitz. You know what? Okay, then we came in. I had in Slovakia, they came in 1944. 42, and they came into my cousins. They took the girls, two big girls and two, a little one didn't. And they took them. They never told them where they are. They didn't know. And when I came in 1944, then I found one of them. My cousin's daughter, one was that. And they was in life. You know what? That time was worse. They hit and they took her. The womb, they took her out. I met her in Israel. She never could have children anymore. That's what they did that time in 1942. But I came as soon as I came in, she was there like an angel. I asked her about her. I never saw her before, but she spoke Hungarian and she told me not to think about anybody. And don't tell them I'm sick. Because the sick, they're taking you right away. They don't want sick. They didn't like the sick people, they didn't like the skinny people. I was very skinny. They didn't like the fat people. How much I lived. I don't know how I did it. I almost 40 pounds. Always was my whole life. Just And then they start to bring me, and then when she came to me, she was all right already. She was Ugamichet already, so they gave her nice clothes, and she worked in an office already, because she suffered so much, they were let they go already. And she had protection. You know, if not them, I wouldn't be here today. So she came, and her mother had protection too because of her. And I went to three times in Mengele's hands, three times when I came in, and when I went in the, I got sick there. They tore up the gacha. They put me in a, they had protection, you know where they put me? The people who went over there where they took the clothes, they put together the clothes from the people who they killed. And that was a good job, because they fooled them. And they told me, I could have everything there. I had a lot of diamonds there and a lot of money, but I tore up all the money. I saved some of my jewelry, but you know what they did? When I came home from work, I had to go through, they lived over there with little houses. They had a ghetto, but they put me in, but I have to go through to a people, you know, they locked me up all the time. Not locked me up, just I couldn't take anything. Grasses I could take, and they didn't let me take medicine, but I did. I opened up my clothes here in the hair, and I put aspirin, what I would do. They had everything. They had so much baby carriage and so much fur coat. It was raining, and then a fire break out there. And you know what? You're not going to believe me. I find my mother's dress in my sister-in-law's, but I didn't even cry, because they put something called brom in the, put something in the food to make us calm down. So not to feel. And I didn't say I want to go there. I said I want to live.
Which camp was it?
Auschwitz. That was the worst. But no, they had Lager, that was the worst. From there, the people went right away over there. And before I worked, and you know, the German officer came in, I was shaken. They took the fat people. Over there, they haven't got enough, so they took more. And once I, you know, it almost was over, and then I have all over cousins, and I never was hungry there, and I had even, it was Bekleidungskammer. There was nightgowns even I have there. Nobody had beautiful shoes, beautiful clothes. Nobody had, this was, this was, I have everything there.
How come?
Because where I have a cousin, my cousin worked in the, you know, Bekleidungskammer, where they gave the clothes out. So they gave me nice clothes. And under I was in the kitchen, they bought me another beautiful dress. It was almost over, then she gave me a blue knit dress in a light blue kerchief, and I put that down in the, I was too beautiful. The Germans took me for an officer and to watch of people, but of Jewish girls.
What did you have to do?
They do nothing. See, that's why I don't want you to. I take a candy strudel away. They wouldn't kill us, but they would punish us.
Why wouldn't they kill you?
Not kill me. No, they wouldn't kill us. They would punish.
Why?
Because I took jewelry.
But why wouldn't they kill you?
They wouldn't kill me. They would punish me why I shouldn't take jewelry. Mm-hmm. That's what they did.
So where did you...
You know, a Jewish girl, they killed a Jew... I saw the girl, they killed a Jewish girl. In life, they threw her in fire because she ran away with a German soldier. And she had a number like I have. And here, and they catch her. They bought her bag, and the whole lager had to go out and listen what they said. They said, if you're going to do the same thing, they're gonna do it with you. And she had a Gillette, and she cut her veins. But you know what they did? They put her in hospital, and they stopped her. And she talked all the bad things from them. They're not to listen. You know, they kill her anyway. And she was alive then when they threw her in the gas chamber in life, the Jewish girl. The Bana Shalalam Yom Kippur in Rosh Hashanah, you know, from the flames was red, was the sky. And you couldn't cry all the time. I was almost there too, I didn't tell you yet. So after, when I was, you know, I was watching up that girls, and it was beautiful days, and I took off my shoes. And suddenly, I don't know what happened, something was in the grass, a needle, or me stuck my needle, and I had blood infection. My feet were so red, I couldn't even walk. And my cousin came and asked me, what's the matter with you? I said, you know, in Mengele came in for a selection. You know, they gave so much, they had a lot of diamonds, my cousin. I couldn't walk, I couldn't do so. They have two women. So there a Russian doctor in, I don't know what the other one was, and they told her, you take care of that girl, I give you diamonds, how much you want. They did. You know they did? Suddenly went down in, when I went back to the block, and he came in the ambulance. I was in the ambulance back. And the Germans had a selection. And you know, when they was calling my, I haven't got a name there, I have this. Then I fell asleep. And I was all right already. And they put me, my number over there to go in the care chamber. You know what I lived through? And when my cousin came, he said, they didn't ask you, they called you? I said, no. And she comes, and I see on her face something is not all right. So when she left, then the Schreiberin came in, you know, Schreiberin office. So she said, when you call out that number, they gotta go, they're gonna move on another house, a block they call. Then I knew what it is. Then I knew. So a woman was there. She had, listen, she has two twins she has, and she took the blood from the two twins and sent that to the German front for the soldiers. And for that, they let her alive, the mother. They gave her good food. And she told me, Hungarian, run away. Where I'm going to run? On the bed? Or when I go to the wires, they have. Hi, there was electric in it. And the Germans gonna see me, I run, they're gonna kill me. I said, I'm not running anywhere. That's my shirt, you know, but I'm gonna leave. If not, I'm gonna be there with my parents and my sisters and brother. I don't want to run. They would kill me if I would run. So I didn't go in Ivan, they took me in the two doctors went away to Mengele and told them that girl is young and my face was red, I was shaken and nothing's matter with her. The Bana Shalalam went down suddenly because the girl took care of me, the doctor, and she's all right. And so, you know what he said, Mengele, it's okay, bring her. Did what happened. So Ivan, and he changed his mind. He said in German language, jetzt kommen Sie mit der Patientin in the last moment. It means you come with her in her last minute, heraus, get out. Then I didn't know what world I am. Well, that's really the other world. In Slovak Jewish girls, was staying and they took me around and they cried. You know, they said that never happens till the lager is on. He called me back. Mengele called me back. in the schiss office for that. And he took out my number, said, and put that in the ad, and to live, to life. In that, you should listen, that night, I was shaking, and she said, don't worry, child, nobody gonna come for you. And that night, my father came to me, I'm never gonna forget, came to my dream, and he came, such, I haven't got time to look for this picture, tall, nice, handsome man, and he looked at me, and they had their bunk beds, and that was here, and I was in the bag, he couldn't find me. And when he find me, he stayed near me and start to cry, and then I waked up, and then I see that was his from them. I came back to life. So the shed gave him, bring him. I didn't change. I am just like my parents was. That way I had Budapest. So many boys, I tell you, I was the most beautiful girl. They all wanted to marry me. I don't want to marry, but not Yiddish, not Jewish. I didn't have troubles or not, couldn't learn nothing. Just like I was in home, my parents. My sister married a modern boy. I raised Talmud Chachamim. So. And then what happened?
You saw Mengele itself? You saw him?
What?
You saw Mengele? You actually saw him?
Yeah, three times. When I came, he took me with my mother, one that side, the other side. I saw him.
What did he look like? Do you remember what he looked like?
He was a handsome, nice man in the 30s. Tall. I saw him when he selected. When I went back to my working camp, there was again a selection, and then I saw him. It was near me. I saw him.
Did you know what he was doing to other people?
They thought we don't know. They were so dumb, they thought we don't know what they're doing. And you know, a big Talmud Chacham, a rabbi where my sister used to live, my married sister, he did this too, and people passed by, and he said to the people, Vashtavek the Siddurlach, you know what this means? Not a word Jewish. He said, throw away the prayer book, because he was a big Talmud, so much Sorum, you know, books, all four walls was full of them. And then after that, they took him there too, because they was afraid somebody else gonna know. They were so dumb, they thought nobody knows. Everybody knows what they're doing. But a bunch of Americans, eh? America don't want to help. They're a big power, America should stop. Who was the president that time? Roosevelt. He was a big Russian, John Kennedy's father was a big... Hitlerist and in little countries helping, that this wasn't enough. The America did do it, then would be at least more people. Good thing they didn't want the war, the Germans. One Jew wasn't being that early, they would care. What's the matter with them today? They have their own country. In Israel, what's going on? They killed the Jewish boys and all this.
Tell me, your father was killed during the war, or he died before the war? Your father?
He went away. He didn't die before the war.
What happened to him?
They went there with the other woman. They did. My father had a lot of money. They said, I can't. Even in the ghetto, they separated my mother and us, and they took him in a shul, and he went with another. They said they're going already. Nobody knows where they took us. They told me if I take a pail of water to the train, I can. They separated us. We didn't run away together. Yeah, to the train, then I can see my father. So I did. But I had to shy this name. They were pressed together in a train, you know, where they're taking the animals, like herrings. And suddenly he came out to the door. But I tell you, I'm never gonna forget that picture. It was staying, and me and my sister was crying, and He said not to cry when we're going to go there. We did go, all right, 2 days after we go to. And when I came in, I saw a friend and a neighbor, and I saw him. He had on a little striped suit. And I asked him, where is my father? I didn't know nothing that time. He said, a roach here, other place. The Banish Island did that, it, because the Jews, they said as the innocent suffer, because they took the Torah, and they're not so haltenish, they're not keeping the Torah, they machal Shabbos, they eat. And when I was in Israel, I saw pig flesh, and I didn't know what to say in Heiligen Land. The Banish Island, they suffered in Avaika, I suffer for that while the others were doing it. That's how it is.
So you came together in the car, in that car, the cattle car, with your mother and your sisters? You went together to the concentration camp?
Yeah.
How was
and my sister-in-law too. Everything happened Shabbos, everything. Shabbos we came in, Shabbos went away from home. Everything happened Shabbos.
They knew that there was something about Shabbos, that they did it deliberately on Shabbos, right?
Yeah, they did it deliberately on Shabbos.
Why?
You're asking me because they...